Without further ado, let's welcome Amanda Breed to the show, co-founder and CEO of MyFlow.
Hi, how are you?
I'm fine, Amanda. I noticed a couple of things about your bio that are very interesting to me. That's the fact that you went to Cornell, and I do have fond memories of the statue that's made of car bumpers out there. It's a pretty cool thing to do. A very beautiful place in the Finger Lakes region, and obviously they taught you very well. I guess the first question I have to think, or the first thing I thought of when I thought of you was Captain James T. Kirk. Are you familiar with that person?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the reason I say that is you've actually decided to go to a brave new frontier above and beyond where anybody else would go with this, and I have to applaud you. That's
Thank you.
That is amazing. How do you decide, or how did you get on this pathway?
So yes, it was pretty serendipitous. I guess I'll start with the fact that I'd always been a mathlete. So the main drive behind my choice to pivot originally from biology to engineering was my love for numbers, not just building things. So when I was surrounded by engineers during grad school at Berkeley, I did feel a pressure to create, not just quantitatively optimize like I was doing. So in my last semester there, I took a course called Critical Making out of the Center for Innovation, Technology, and Research in the Interest of Society, where we worked on tangible inventions to solve real problems. And for the last assignment, we were put in random teams and tasked to come up with a wearable device that, by collecting data on its users, somehow improved their quality of life. And that's where we came up with a connected tampon, and were encouraged to, by the reaction to our presentation in class, to not just let it stop at a class project.
Fabulous. One thing that stands out also is the fact that you spent a lot of time in engineering and operations research. I recall back in my days in college and looking at those two things, it looks like they served you fairly well in creating the product, not just from the fact that you had the idea, but also the engineering and the process flow that you use to make a product like this. Can you kind of address that?
Yeah, of course. So like I was mentioning, that kind of stems out of its relation to math and its ability to make decision-making into a quantitative analytical exercise. So I do have a STEM background. I studied science in college and then engineering in grad school, but I'd always volunteered as a kid. I preferred school to camp. I didn't really enjoy stuff like the movies or shopping. I felt uncomfortable wearing name brands, which made me sort of a weirdo. So it's not really surprising that I ended up in a series of events that led me to creating a, well, weird market disrupting product.
Well, I don't know if weird is necessarily the word for it. One thing that you indicate in a lot of the literature you have is that we all have a story of something like that that's occurred where we may not have been prepared to deal with it. Now, obviously, I'm a guy, and I don't have a personal story, but I do have other stories of people that I know who have gone through this. I guess the one thing that I would ask you is that, obviously, it takes a tremendous amount of courage and a care for this particular issue to go out and do this. What drove you to really want to make this product in mainstream versus just being a laboratory project?
Yeah, so I'd also been active in the women's health and advocacy spaces prior to founding MyFlow. I was an actress in college in the annual Vagina Monologues production. I was an intern at my local family shelter growing up, working with survivors of domestic abuse, and a peer counselor for the crisis and anxiety hotline at Cornell. So my dream was always essentially to combine my nerdy and philanthropic sides, and that's how I was able to do that with MyFlow.
One thing that stands out about MyFlow and that really just really kind of comes home for me, it also, for the most part, looks at and examines the fact that you actually did go to Berkeley, is the data that you can derive from a device like this. Talk about the data play on this particular type of device.
Of course. So our tampon monitor alerts its user to the saturation level of her tampon via notification on her phone. It's Bluetooth enabled. Generally, we're out to eliminate the shame and anxiety stemming from the risk of leaking, discomfort, toxic shock syndrome, which is a bacterial infection caused by leaving your tampon in too long that currently inevitably plague women's periods. Virtually, as you mentioned, that had not happened to you personally, obviously, but that you had heard of, you know, virtually other women and virtually every woman you know has either stained or their clothing on multiple cycles, forgotten whether they put their tampon in, or wasted an immense amount of cash on taking their tampons out too early. And as you mentioned, the data angle is crucial as well. Right now, there really isn't a database that exists of an aggregation of menstrual flow data of, in terms of frequency, a lot of the biological data in that rich fluid is just gone. And this would be a way with users' consent to learn about menstruation, which obviously happens to half the world's population for half of our lives. And because it's so taboo, is not really given much credence in terms of studying.
That's the one thing that stands out, I think, more than anything else, is your ability to attack the taboo, and also understand that the fact that with attacking it comes a tremendous amount of information about the entire ecosystem known as women, as we see today. So that's something to keep in mind, too. One of the things you have interest in is that you have, obviously, a women's health angle to this and advocacy. Talk to us a little bit more about how you see this as a global product when you think about the advocacy for women, women's health, and women's information about women's health.
Of course. We definitely wanted to frame this going out to the market as not something that's, you know, a luxury product, like a lot of Internet of Things and connected devices are these days. This is an every woman's problem, so we want it to be an every woman's product. And I delved during, you know, my time as running the company into a lot of the different practices around the world. For example, my startup was incubated for 3 months in China, so I lived there last year for 3 months. And in most places in China, tampons aren't even sold over the counter at all. It's more of Asia, and a lot of South America, for traditional reasons, are more pad heavy. And so this really alerted me as to the global differences and the ways in which the market segments would be structured differently for this product.
Going forward, based on what you just said, you mentioned the market segmentation associated with the product, and we have about a minute or so left here. Talk about the differences or what you see as the innovations going forward for this product that may or may not necessarily be consistent with the current delivery device. Would it be available for other delivery devices?
Yeah, sure. While menstrual innovation has been embarrassingly lagging historically, So it is about time that women have a smart device to prevent both staining and leakage. But there have been really exciting innovations in the field, from monthly subscriptions to other devices that help with pain management and symptom prevention and minimization, to tracking apps. And there really is something out there for everybody, it seems. So it's exciting that this field is finally getting the attention it deserves.
In our final 30 seconds here or so, give me an idea what you see as the vision for this product and how you expect to educate women on how to use it.
Great. Yeah. Many people are already shocked this doesn't exist. Of the hundreds of women we've talked to, over half are ready to buy a product that helps them prevent leakage. And 82% are ready to buy a product to reduce the risk and anxiety associated with toxic shock syndrome. So we're really out to eliminate the shame and stigma associated with the period and bring peace of mind.
Perfect. Amanda, thank you very much for joining us. I appreciate your courage, your innovation, and your brilliant mind for bringing this product to us. If people want to know more about your product, where can they go?
So our website is trackmyflow.com. That's also where we live on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, AngelList, Crunchbase. So yeah, please reach out if you want to learn more.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Amanda. We appreciate you joining us today, and we look forward to hearing more from you and more innovative products.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. That was Amanda Brief, co-founder and CEO of MindFlow. We'll be right back with the Private Equity Moment. This section brought to you by Notify, the CRM of the future.